to Entrepreneur on Air, where we bring you the stories behind the visionaries that are transforming the world, presented by the entrepreneurial cell of the Commerce Society. We are here with Mr. Ritwik Khare, the pioneering founder of Elivas. His impressive experiences include roles as COO at Make My Trip and Lead Schools. His journey truly exemplifies exceptional leadership and forward thinking. Hello, sir.
Hi, just call me Ritwik.
Ritwik, SRCC and FMS are two prestigious institutions.
Yeah.
So, were there some standout moments in your journey?
Yeah, I think making it to FMS was amazing. Making it to SRCC probably was more amazing.
Yeah.
Those days, getting into SRCC was 87.5%, I remember. Now, I don't think 87.5% will cut it anymore. But I think both these colleges are a matter of great pride, and I think just the entry point and getting to meet in both these institutes an outstanding range of colleagues, students, fellow students, and more importantly, world-class faculty. I think that was, both of these were absolutely standout moments for me. Enjoyed my journey in DU, literally 5 years there. My wife was in DU as well at that time.
That's great.
So she's been with me since my school days. So we made the best of everything, right? Had a good time studying, had a good time networking, and had a great time enjoying the college life as well, which is how it should be.
Were you aware of the society concept in colleges? At that time, were there the society concept like we have today?
Yeah, absolutely. We used to have, a lot of societies in FMS as well as SRCC. Both of them, and very active, including our fests.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, I haven't been to a fest in the last 25 years, but I'm assuming they have become bigger, better, brighter. But still, even those days, it used to be amazing to attend, and it was all done by the students. So everything was society and club led. And some, I was part of the marketing club in FMS. I was part of the I was part of one club in SRCC. I don't remember which one.
Okay.
But then I became the treasurer of FMS student body in the next year.
Yeah.
I'll give you a very little bit insight into how FMS runs. FMS is the highest ROI B school in the country. I remember my school B school fees was 8,000 rupees per year, and obviously the rest, you all know how FMS gives a great break to people for their careers. So, huge indebtedness to my alma mater, both of the institutes. But yes, clubs were an important part.
So the exposure there, did that help you in your entrepreneurial or corporate journey?
I mean, corporate, no doubt. SRCC as well as FMS, I think what these, and including Hansraj, by the way, Hansraj was also one of my shortlisted colleges where I wanted to be. I think what these institutes do is that they get you surrounded by great people. You challenge yourself every day because you're surrounded by the best minds.
And also, I guess that networking factor
that comes in later. But while you're at the institute, those 3 years plus 2 years, I think you get the ability to know that you have to stretch your own limits, and that happens only because you're surrounded by the best, right? And that's what makes a great institute versus a institute which are just coming up now.
Yeah.
And thankfully, India will see a lot of good institutes. I did a 2 year stint, 2.5 year stint with a lovely education company, Lead School. And how we are building education in India is going to just transform, and you will see a lot many more world-class institutes coming out of India.
Yeah.
And you will see a reverse trend where people will come back to study in Indian institutes rather than always just wanting to go abroad.
Yeah. So, so you said that you used to study in the last 10 days in SRCC in your graduation.
And that was not supposed to be shared on this podcast.
So sorry.
Not the best inspiration for everyone, but that's the truth.
Yeah. So how does that transformation occur to be a gold medalist in FMS?
No, see, I mean, not to say that we never studied in SRCC.
Yeah.
See, the good thing is that if you are, okay, here is the thing. I think there's something about being mindful.
Yeah.
I think if you're very, very focused in those 40 minutes of the lecture, 45 minutes of the lecture, I think you end up retaining a lot. Right. And, and obviously when we say it this way that you only studied in the last 10 days, it did a little bit more throughout the year as well. But yes, FMS was challenging. FMS was very competitive. FMS was, the best minds in those days, only about a 60-65 member batch. So the best brains from across the world, across the country. So in FMS, obviously the whole rhythm became a little more relevant to say that you got to be more regular. The curriculum trains you to do that, by the way. And the other thing which I felt was important, and which is what led to Elevas as well. I'm a firm believer of the fact that you will do well in life and your passion meets your expertise.
Yeah.
So I was lucky in FMS to choose subjects which were actually of my interest area.
Yeah.
And which were of my, you know, strength as well. And I think that's very important, because ultimately you've got to be, you'll do well only when you get your passion to meet your expertise.
True.
And I think that's how Elevas is, you know, kind of trying to do something, you know, in a small way in the second home ownership space, in the luxury travel space, because our passion for travel, our passion for real estate is meeting our expertise in both these spaces.
So how did your family reacted when you decided to move away from the corporate sector to your own startup? Because of course we come from that hardcore Indian families. If you have financial stability, it's fine. But suddenly something risky comes and everything is like.
So I think the biggest support I had was from my wife. She always knew that I'll be happiest being my own destiny maker. And I think I got the maximum support and encouragement from her. Not to say that, actually my 13-year-old daughter, she was very encouraging as well. And my parents just asked me once, are you sure of this? And you have enough savings to take care of your, you know, in case a couple of years don't go well. So that's it. I think huge encouragement from my wife actually at the core of it. And somewhere to be very honest, you know, I have always been a very, very different risk taker as far as my corporate career is concerned. So from that point of view, it was not something which seemed very, very, you know, very, very strong as a challenge to take on. And I worked with two or three startups, make my trip. I think yesterday I heard Deep say that we are a 24-year-old startup.
Yeah.
Right. So make my trip was very startup-ish. Lead School was a very good startup.
Yeah.
So I'd seen founders work up close and personal in that sense. So I think that gave me the encouragement and confidence that, look, I think I can also do. And, ultimately, finding a great co-founder and a great starting management team. So, Karan, you know, Vikram, Aman, Kriti, the four folks who came together to build this. I think that also gave a lot of confidence that, look, if there are four or five of us to do this, we can really make a good killing out of it.
So, did you have any plan B if this plan didn't work out, like at that time, when you started to, you know, think about Elevas?
See, honestly, no. Because that's something which, when I left Citibank, nobody used to leave Citibank. When I joined a travel company knowing nothing about travel and a dot-com in that sense, people won't leave a whole career in BFSI to move to travel. When I left Make My Trip as a CEO and joined Lead School, nobody knew that much versus Make My Trip as a brand. Never, I genuinely feel that if you, again, goes back to that point, I believe that if my passion and expertise can come together, I don't think you need to be worried about a plan B.
Yeah.
And yeah, I mean, what's the, you'll give 3-4 years, you'll make it big. If you won't make it big, I don't think you are, you know, we're all, and one of the things Rajan and the Peak 15 team keep telling us now, the world will live till 1995. We are just not even out there.
Yeah.
So we have enough time to make it up in case, you know, there's.
True.
Yeah. But if you think of plan B, plan A generally won't work out. So I don't get into anything thinking of plan B.
Okay, that's great. So how did your experience at Make My Trip shape your approach towards entrepreneurship? And are there any specific lessons you learned from there and you still follow them?
So first and foremost, I think working very closely with the three founders, co-founders and founders at Make My Trip. I think Deep, Kalra, Rajesh Mago and even Kayur Joshi was the co-founder when I joined. I think watching them closely, personally, getting inspired by them, being in the same room for hours together with them, I think played a large role in influencing how I should look at leadership, how I should look at, you know, scaling companies, how I should look at, you know, attacking the marketplace and holding forth and being at it resiliently for decades together, right? So that's how the mindset got trained, working closely with some of the best founders in the world, I would say. And I think some of the valuable lessons on the, I'm going to go back because it's very important. The passion stroke expertise, And the passion for travel was always there, but then it became more an expertise because I was inside a travel company, one of the world's best travel companies. So I think both of these led to a strong foundation, which today is serving Elevas quite well.
Yeah, truly, sir.
Yeah.
So the travel and tourism industry is quite competitive. So what strategies do you use to differentiate Elevas from their competitors?
If you look at it this way, what are we in the business of? We are in the business of real estate and travel.
Yeah.
The culmination of real estate coming together with travelers or travel. Both my spaces on the demand side and supply side are growing upwards of 25-30% per annum.
Great.
The market is already huge. I am only targeting a very small fraction of that market share. I don't think we need to worry about how competitive it is. I don't think we need to worry about, because the market is huge and growing like never before. India for luxury, India for travel, India for luxury real estate. You will see the next 10 years booming, next 20 years booming like never before.
Yeah.
So I think the approach is not about worrying about competition.
Yeah.
The approach right now is to stay focused and true to your two or three key stakeholders. So if you really look at it for us, who are my external stakeholders? My external stakeholders are the homeowner as well as the traveler.
Yeah.
And who are my internal stakeholders? It's my colleagues and my investors.
Yeah.
And people who backed us. So as long as both these internal and external stakeholders we stay true to and stay obsessed about their outcomes and their prerogatives, I don't think we need to worry about competition. And in fact, I would love for it to be a very nice competitive space.
Yeah.
Because there's just too much to do.
Yeah, truly, sir.
And there's enough for everyone to eat.
Yeah. So, sir, I can see a poster there, team first. So, my question comes from there. It's like, how do you try to build a motivated team? Because, you know, employees being the greatest asset of any organization.
So, we have three values. Trust and transparency, team first, and taking action.
Yeah.
We keep it very simple. I've had good feedback to this, bad feedback to this, but I think for now this is very focused for us. For building large teams, I've only followed two or three, thumb rules. One is I always look for very passionate people to start with. So that makes a lot of difference.
Yeah.
Two, I always focus on diversity. So when I say diversity of experience, diversity of education, diversity of gender, diversity of talent, so you build a very robust team, which is very diverse in their thinking, and they always add to each other. And the third most important thing today, and this is true for millennials, Gen Zs, both, is that you've got to get people to do very meaningful work. If you get people to understand and believe that they make a difference,
yeah,
I think half the job is done. So if you have selected right passionate people, we are not doing rocket science, so
yeah,
you know, passion does a large part of the job. If you are able to get them a lot of support system through a diversified makeup of the team.
Yeah.
And thirdly, you make them believe that what they are doing is very meaningful and is creating impact in the world or in the industry or in the market or whichever way. Then the task is done, right,
yeah,
in that sense. And obviously, over the number of years, we've learned as managers, yeah, as leaders, we keep making mistakes. I make a lot of mistakes even today. And as long as we go back and have an honest conversation with ourselves that today I made this mistake, let me learn from it, and tomorrow let me not do this with the team. And the team appreciates that, the team understands that. And going back to my second value on trust and transparency, we are absolutely crystal clear transparent with everybody in the team. And I think that creates a lot of trust both,
yeah,
ways. And that helps them in feeling a part of the team as much as the founders are.
Yeah. So since you told us that you have a lunch on every Saturday with the team, which is great because that,
yeah,
will create a sense of belongingness,
yeah,
to the team, to the company, that they are important, right?
Yes.
So that's something really great.
Absolutely. No, and that's a good opportunity for us to just connect. It's also my small bribe to get them to come to office on Saturday. No,
yeah,
just joking. It's just a way to, you know, kind of do one day together.
Space. No, at one point there were very less people who knew about travel and real estate accommodation and such. And we know that there were already existing players like Stay Vista and Saffron Stays. What made Elevas different? What did you think makes it different from others?
So You know, one is obviously these are great companies. They started about a decade back. They have done phenomenal work in creating the category. I think some of the things that we believe are very different with Elevas. One is, so this is what I call as the pet differentiators, PET. We say that we have, and in no particular order, we have a very strong way of attracting people and the best talent, because ultimately you're serving the homeowner and the traveler.
Right.
And who's going to serve them? Talent is going to serve them, right? Second, over the last two and a half decades, all of us have built a lot of execution muscle. And I think our execution machinery is very, very focused and is very targeted. That's why we're at 140 properties in about 10-12 months since launch. And third, and like I said, again, in no particular order, but it's just the PET, is we are very tech first. So my co-founder, Karan, I think has been in the space of product and technology in the villa space with global companies and Indian companies over the last 10 years. So he brings in a very tech first approach to how we look at the problems for the homeowner, for the housekeeper, as well as for the traveler.
Right.
Some differentiators on model, etc., but I want to keep that a little to ourselves.
Okay.
But and some of the ways we get supply onboarded and we get customer acquisition is very IP led. In fact, we just announced an alliance with Visa cards, so that gives us a lot of opportunity to send out our message to 70% of India's cardholders. So all of that is the way we goes back to the PET that I spoke about.
So you mentioned tech savvy, being tech savvy. Do you think there were a lot of challenges when it comes to that, being tech savvy in this industry?
No, not at all. Actually, in fact, this was one of the key things which I think Karan and me got excited about together. See, who are the three people who are relevant stakeholders for this to be a great experience for the homeowner as well as the traveler? You got to solve for the traveler, you got to solve for the homeowner, and very importantly, we've got to solve for the housekeeper,
right?
The person who's going to deliver this. We are building a company at scale, and unlike a hotel which is, let's say, 200, 500, 700 rooms in one building, we have 200 rooms across 50 locations, or we have 500 rooms across literally 150 locations. So for us, technology plays a large role in how do you maintain the same effectiveness which a good five-star brand keeps, yet gives you the phenomenal experience of staying in somebody's private home. And when the two come together, you have a super powerful proposition in hand.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the only thing which can help you do that at scale is a very strong tech first approach and a tech backend.
So that will be your powerful move.
Absolutely.
Right.
Actually, all three, people, execution and technology, I think, and that's what we call the pet, the Elevas pet.
So within the last year, you have had a valuation of about around $13 million. How do you go on to carry such a large company?
No, we are very small. We are very, very small, and we are not focused on valuation at all.
Okay.
I think the only two things I'm focused on is how many consumers can I serve for an experience which becomes a memory for them for their lifetime. And the other is obviously how can I keep my homeowners, super, super happy. Our mission is very simple. We want to make it very, very enriching to own a second home and very, very enriching to do a short-term vacation rental with us. So those are the two external stakeholders. And for our internal stakeholders, which is my employees and my investors, I'm only very, very keen to deliver value to them respectively. So at this stage, not focused on the valuation. And contrary to what you said, we are very small, we are very young, and we've just begun. It's not even day zero right now.
Right. So you have had a good experience in the corporate environment. As we know, that is evolving very rapidly. What's one tip you would like to give to the young professionals that are still navigating in today's corporate culture?
Yeah, so if there's one tip, there would be few things I would tell my daughter as she starts thinking about her career. She's just 13, but very soon she'll start thinking something about it. But the one thing that I would tell her is that, look, and it might not be easy, by the way, is that if you can find an area of your passion, rest of the things don't matter. If you can figure out what gets the best out of you, and this is an area which brings out your passionate best, and the rest will follow. So if your passion is meeting customers, if your passion is doing a lot of high-tech work, if your passion is, doing robotics, if your passion is to say that, look, I'm going to be in performing arts, whatever is your passion, If your passion is to say, I'm going to help people become healthier, if your passion is to say, I'm going to solve legal challenges in the world, and I enjoy building those kind of blocks, I think the rest will follow. So if there is one thing I would advise, don't go by a societal herd mentality. Don't go by the pressures you face and you come across in the people around you or from the people around you. As long as you, but yes, it's not easy. If you can identify your passion, you're lucky and you'll do well.
So follow your passion.
Absolutely.
Now we'll go on to the rapid fire round. This is a segment that it will be very fast, very quick, very fun. What's your favorite travel destination?
In India, Goa.
One skill every entrepreneur should have.
Resilience.
If not entrepreneurship, what would you be doing?
I think I would be running another company.
Biggest myth about entrepreneurship?
It's very tough.
It's not.
It is not.
Work-life balance, real or myth?
Work-life balance, overrated.
If you had to pitch Elivas in one sentence, what would that be?
Enriching lives of homeowners and travelers.
Best advice you received in business?
Follow your dreams.
Who gave you that advice?
I mean, many people, but that I'll keep to myself.
All right. One thing every startup should avoid at all costs.
Being focused on valuation.
If you could have dinner with one entrepreneur, living or dead, who would that be?
Yeah, I had many dinners with Deep and Rajesh and Kayur. So if there's any one other person, I think it would be Elon Musk.
Elon Musk.
Yeah,
I would love that too.
Yeah.
So coming to the final question, if there's one advice you would like to give to the 18-year-old Ritwik, what would that be?
I think, honestly, when we were growing up, the India of 1990s was very different from the India of 2020s. It was a India which had just started realizing its potential or thinking about its potential, not even realizing. And it was an India where opportunities were still just about starting. So it was a very scarcity mindset. I think the advice I would give to the Ritwik of 18 years would be that don't take life so seriously. Go with the flow and follow your passion.
For those who are starting their own business currently, what's one piece of advice you would give to them?
Don't get into the business if you do not genuinely identify and feel passionately about the problem you're trying to solve. That's it. I mean, and like I said, I am a very young entrepreneur. I'm no one to give advice. There are so many in India. As you've seen, whether it's the corporate world CEOs or entrepreneurs, India has produced amazing people whom we get inspired by. But jaise kehte hai na, chota muh badi baat. If I have to say, I would say this, that if you cannot identify with the problem deeply, if you cannot feel passionate about the problem you're solving, don't become an entrepreneur in that area.
Thank you for joining us. It's been a great pleasure to be with you. Until next time.
Thank you and all the best to you guys.